हेलो सर।
हेलो, स्ट्रीमिंग स्टार्टेड है।
ओके ओके ठीक है। ओके
सर, पता नहीं, मैं जूम का लिंक, मेरा नॉट रिस्पॉन्डिंग आ रहा है। मैं वापस अभी वो बंद करके फिर से स्टार्ट कर रहा हूँ। मैं अभी भी तो मैं सर उसमें आईडी पासवर्ड भी डाला है, लेकिन तब भी उससे ब्लैंक स्क्रीन आ रहा है, कुछ आ नहीं रहा है उसके ऊपर।
वेट फॉर 5 मिनट्स। मिस्टर इस्माइल फोकल इज गोइंग टू ज्वाइन। सम टेक्निकल एरर इज फेसिंग, सो विल वेट फॉर 2 मिनट्स। ओके, तो मिस्टर इस्माइल जॉइन। सो गुड इवनिंग वन एंड ऑल हु आर रजिस्टर्ड एंड प्रेजेंट ओवर हियर फॉर द वन डे नेशनल वेबिनार ऑन सिस्टमैटिक प्रोसेस इंजीनियरिंग ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग, भारतीय विद्यापीठ कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग and in association with Institution of Engineers India, Belapur Local Center and Top Polymers FZC UAE. Hello all, my name is Mahesh Suryavanshi, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemical Engineering, Bharati Vidyapeeth College of Engineering, Navi Mumbai. Welcome you all to this national level webinar on systematic process engineering. So it's my great privilege to welcome some of the dignitaries from Bharati Vidyapeeth. So I would like to welcome our visionary man and the source of our inspiration, Dr. Patangrauji Kadam Saheb, who has developed this Bharati Vidyapeeth in the year 1965. Next, we have our beloved Dr. Shivaji Rao Kadam, sir, Chancellor, Bharati Vidyapeeth, deemed to be university. Then we have our young and dynamic personality, Dr. Vishwajit Kadam, sir, who is the Pro Vice Chancellor of Bharati Vidyapeeth. And we have Vice Chancellor, Dr. Manik Rao Sanghe, sir. Then I would like to welcome already Dr. Vilas Rao Kadam, sir, who is the Director, Bharati Vidyapeeth Educational Complex, Navi Mumbai. Dr. Sandhya Jadhav, ma'am, Principal, Bharati Vidyapeeth College of Engineering, Navi Mumbai. And Dr. Shambhala Shingare, ma'am, Head of the Department, Chemical Engineering. I welcome all of them to this one-day national webinar on systematic process engineering. Now, I would like to extend my sincere appreciation to our today's guest, Mr. K.K. Varkhedkar, sir, Chairman, IEI Belapur Local Center, and today's keynote speaker, Mr. Ismail Khokawala, Technical Director, Top Polymers, FZC UAE, for accepting our invitation and grace the webinar with their presence. Without taking much of your time, I would like to introduce first today's guest to our webinar, Mr. K.K. Varkhedkar, sir. Mr. K.K. Varkhedkar, sir, has completed his bachelor's in civil engineering in 1982 from VNIT Nagpur. Then he has joined CIDCO as executive engineer. He has associated with the CIDCO from last 29 years. Currently, he is retired from the CIDCO with the post of Chief Engineer and General Manager, Technology Section. He has many achievements in his name, like one of them is the use of FAB technology for development of Kharghar and Ulve node. He has also felicitated by Chief Minister of Maharashtra on successful completion of Vastu Vihar complex in Kharghar in the year 2010. Now, he is currently a chairman of Belapur Local Center Institution of Engineers India and a member of Indian Concrete Institute. Now, I request Mr. Varkhedkar, sir, to say a few words.
Good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good evening to all of you. I am thankful to the organizers of this event. Professor Suryavanshi, Dr. S. D. Jadhav, Dr. P. S. Shingare for inviting me on this occasion. Today we have Mr. Ismail Khokawala, Director, Top Polymers, Dubai, as a distinguished speaker on this occasion. Friends, Institution of Engineers, as Mr. Suryavanshi told that I retired from CIDCO in 2019 and I'm associated with Institution of Engineers since 2018 as chairman of that institute. Belapur Local Center is established in 1994 and we have completed 25 years of our existence. Recently, we have celebrated our Silver Jubilee also, when host of dignitaries from across the country were present. And it was a very memorable event for all of us. We had organized many workshops, many seminars. And important thing was that we had associated, with many of the student chapters from various colleges of Navi Mumbai, and even beyond Navi Mumbai from Vasai Virar also. The fact is that the collaboration of Institution of Engineers with the student chapter assumes a lot of importance. Both of the entities get benefited out of this association. Belapur Local Center has a vast jurisdiction. It is covering Thane, Raigad, Ratnagiri, Sindhudurg, and we have almost 3,700 members with us. And they are actually from the 15 disciplines of engineering. We have very two big industrial areas also in Navi Mumbai, like Mape in Thane district and Taloja in Raigad district. And as all of you know, that it has got number of, particularly in Taloja, number of chemical factories, and many of the persons with the technical expertise engaged in these units are also associated with the Institution of Engineers. So you can really imagine that we have a vast pool of the people who are associated with us, and thereby we can have a very good exchange of technical knowledge by association with each other. And I am congratulating the Department of Chemical Engineering, Bharati Vidyapeeth, to have an association with us, and we'll continue to have that kind of a association for mutual benefit of each other. Through our student chapter, we are organizing a number of events, and we have found that this has become very useful for the students also, because in our Silver Jubilee function also, we had instituted a lot of awards and in various disciplines like civil, electrical, mechanical, chemical, and we received a lot of projects from the students. They were very enthusiastic, and I'm very happy to say that many innovative ideas were found in those presentations, and we had equally awarded them with suitable certification, mementos, etc., to give an encouragement to these activities in our area, because that is the primary objective of the Institution of Engineers. We have a very good infrastructure in CBD Navi Mumbai. Many of you must have visited our building, which is in Sector 15 at Belapur, which has got 5 floors. We have a very vast and very good library with us, where the students can come. Normally, nowadays, this trend has become very less. The people are more or less used to the computers and internet and all that. But there is a good collection of books in our library, and it is free for everybody. So anybody can come and use that library also. We have a very good auditorium with a sitting capacity of 110 members. We are organizing a lot of seminars, workshops in that auditorium. We have got consulting rooms also. For example, if the industry and their technical experts want to organize some small meetings, they can use the premises of Institution of Engineers, Belapur Local Center. There are 2-3 rooms, whereas, you know, there is a small conference room which is attached with each room. People can give their presentation, and such meetings can be held very successfully also. So as you find out that such large benefits are being offered by the Belapur Local Center, and I am hopeful, and I wish, and I appeal to all of you to take maximum advantage of these facilities which are available in the close vicinity of you. And we should have more and more such interactions with all the departments, all the colleges who are in the vicinity of Navi Mumbai, to have a proper exchange of knowledge. And so that the objective of Institution of Engineers, which is very clear, to disseminate the knowledge, to ensure that the knowledge goes to the people for whom it is actually required. So that gets actually fulfilled, and that purpose is achieved. I think with these words, I will take your leave, and I am very confident this webinar will be a grand success with the presence of the distinguished people who are there, and all the participants will take the full advantage of this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind words of guidance and the information about IEI, Belapur Local Center. Now, before moving further, sir is engaged with some other assignments in IEI Center. So they are taking a leave from here. Thank you, sir. Thank you for accepting our invitation and present as a guest for this webinar. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, we'll move towards introduction of our today's keynote speaker, Mr. Ismail Kokawala. So Mr. Kokawala is a pass out of Bharati Vidyapeeth College of Engineering in the year 2007. Then he qualified the GATE exam with All India rank 725. And by this, he completed his master's in chemical engineering from ICT in 2009. During this master's, he had published two research papers in reputed journals. So the campus itself, he got selected in UPL Limited, who is a giant in agrochemical sector. Now he worked over there for almost 8 years as executive process engineer at corporate R&D center. His work profile was process development, process improvisation, technology transfer from lab to plant, safety studies and hazard, evaluation of thermophysical data and generation of VLE curves. While working with UPL, he has designed number of equipments like fixed bed reactor, batch and semi-batch reactors, batch and continuous distillation columns, high vacuum distillation columns, filtration units, etc. His focus over there was to develop process with maximum yield at optimum cost and with minimum effluent, and process should be environmental friendly. After leaving UPL in 2016, he moved to UAE and joined his family business. Now he currently working over there as technical director, Top Polymers FZC Ajman Dubai. He holds versatile profile right from raw material purchase to the selling of product. Since he worked in all the areas of right from beginning to the end of product and process development. After joining the business, he has developed 7 new products called additive packages. One of the best kind of thing he has done is in life, that 7 new products he has developed. And also started a manufacturing of it. In the span of these 3 years, product is accepted and sold more than 13 countries, 13. So you can imagine in 13 countries, the product is accepted and sold, like Colombia, Nigeria, South Africa, some of these other countries. About his manufacturing capabilities, in the year 17 and 18, his production was around 220 metric ton average. But due to his continuous efforts and the skills in the research and development, in 2019, it crossed 750 metric tons. And in 2020, it crossed 1,000 metric tons. So one of the great things he has done. Recently, Mr. Ismail and his friend, Dr. Amey Durve, both are the batchmates, has started one consultancy in the area of basic and detailed process engineering. So apart from this, Mr. Ismail have number of other hobbies like playing a cricket. He has won many awards in cricket tournaments in India as well as in UAE. Even he has associated with one of the club and playing for one team in UAE. So he is such a kind of multi-talented personality with us today, and we are really proud to have such alumni in our department. So I request Mr. Ismail to start with the session. Before starting with the session, some instructions I wanted to convey to the participants. First is please mute your audio. Second is if you have any questions during the session, you can write in Zoom chat box or YouTube chat box. Thank you. Now I request Ismail to start with the session.
Hi, sir. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, yes.
Just a moment. Hello. Am I audible? Hello.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Because I was hearing my own sound. Okay. Thank you, sir, for your brief introduction. Now, I will not spend much time. We'll just start the presentation. Just a moment.
Yes, Ismail.
Is my voice proper now? Somebody wrote that my voice is echoing.
Now it is proper.
It's okay. Yeah. Right. Okay. Okay. So, can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. So, let's begin with some aspects of process engineering. Okay. So I have specifically highlighted the word systematic because process engineering is such a versatile field in the chemical engineering world that you really require a precise and very systematic calculation. That's why I specifically highlighted the words systematic, so to draw attention of you all who are interested in process engineering, because process engineering is such a field for a process engineer, because they are not only dealing because the process engineer deals with a lot of people in the chemical industry. They deal with they have very dynamic profile and very versatile job profile and have a very deep responsibility for the process, because they are dealing with the research and development people. They are dealing with the projects team, they are dealing with the commissioning and erection team, they are dealing with the fabricators, they are dealing also with the consultant. So process engineering is a guy who connects all these points together to make sure that the process is complete. So that, you know, a process when goes from lab to plant, whatever data is required to generate to make sure the process goes with safety, then the aspect with the process engineer covers is that the product should have maximum yield and at an optimum cost. So a process engineer is a guy who has a deep vision of the process. He knows what goes wrong, what is with the process. So he looks into every aspect of the process, because there are some certain calculations which I will go through during the course of the presentation, because this presentation, the calculation which I will share with you are something like you need to imagine as a process engineer that how a system can go wrong, because I believe that every process engineer is a chemical engineer, but all chemical engineers are not process engineers. So process engineer is such a field where you should have a deep vision for the process, a deep thinking. You should, or rather I would say that you should have an ability to think out of the box. So just a moment, it again got stuck. Okay, so today's agenda would be, I will be covering some part of, just a moment. So it's very important for a process engineer to understand what is the physics of a chemistry, heat of reaction and its physical significance, reaction kinetics, and the data generation, what data you can generate from the reaction kinetic curve, because this curve is not only subjected to evaluate the rate constant and the order of the reaction. Many other data can be generated through this curve. So we'll look into that aspect as well. Heat transfer in the agitated vessel and the selection of the jacket. So basically, from process engineering point of view, I will cover the reaction kinetics part, and I will try to cover as much as for the heat transfer part. So process engineering, safety. Now I could have wrote down the word safety in the same font as well, but just to draw your attention, I have put a picture over there, because pictures are more elaborative rather than giving a description over there. Because here you can see that the word safety, the every alphabet is has been held by six different persons. So this picture clearly indicates that safety is not an individualistic job. It is a job of an entire team. If you have a team of, for example, you can say 10 members, and if one member is being very complacent or lenient about the safety aspect, then there might be some loopholes from safety point of view and process engineering aspect. So in the picture, you can what you can see on the left side, the keywords mentioned over there. So during the course of the process development, a process engineer has to deal with all this type of the words. So you know, they have to make the process accordingly, so that directly or indirectly they are subjected to these keywords. So the first and foremost criteria for the process engineer is that he should design a process that is completely safe. Because it is rightly said by someone that when a doctor commits a mistake, life of a single person is at the stake. But when a chemical engineer makes a mistake, and there is, for example, there is an explosion in the plant, because if the reactor is not designed properly and there is an explosion in the plant, minimum I think 20 people are present in the plant in any shift. So the life of 20 people is at the stake. So safety should be the utmost target while designing any process. So from process engineering point of view, safety is not an event. It is a process for continual improvement. So you need to work continuously so to make sure that the process is 100% safe. So, and safety is such a thing that does not come by chance. It's come by some concentrated effort, because you need to understand the process by every angle and perspective. Because in the plant, when the plant is designed, only one reaction goes in the plant. But there are so for making a product, there is one reaction. But there may be 10, 20, or maybe 100 different ways for that reaction to create a disaster in the plant. So you need to design a process from safety point of view. Because there is an old saying by Mr. Trevor Kletz. He is called as the process designing, the father of the process of safety. So he rightly said once that if you think safety is expensive, try an accident. So this is a very beautiful saying. I will repeat again for you that if you think that safety is expensive, try an accident. So you will get an idea that how people take safety so importantly when designing the process. So basically, now type of reaction and reactor. So basically in chemical industry, there are reactions like liquid-liquid, gas-liquid, liquid-solid reaction, gas-liquid-solid reaction. There is no other reaction apart from all this reaction. So based on this reaction selection, we have a precise the reactor designed for each and every reactor reaction. So we select a particular reactor for a particular reaction. So like, for example, when you have a liquid-liquid reaction or gas-liquid solid reaction, we normally take a CSTR and go ahead with it. So there are few expect to select this. We'll cover it, how to cover all this. So let us understand the physics of the chemistry. Now what you are saying that the reaction is says that A plus B with some process condition will give you product and a byproduct. So this is how a reaction is mentioned in the literature or the textbooks which you refer. But from process engineering point of view, this reaction is still incomplete for me. If I am a process engineer, this reaction is still incomplete for me, because this is hidden into it. Because as a process engineer, you are not only concentrated yourself to product and byproduct, you should also know what are impurities, what gases are generated, and what is the amount of the unreacted reactant remaining inside the reaction mass. Because the right hand side of this reaction this reaction will be feed for the displacement column, for example. So you need to understand every aspect of the compound which is generated in the reaction, because sometimes I think in my last presentation I had covered for the distillation how that impurities are minimum like 1% or maximum 2%, but how this 1% impurity can have an impact on the entire reaction and can change the dynamics of the process engineering that I have covered in my last webinar. So I will focus a little bit on how impurities needs to be identified in the later stage of the presentation as well. Because we know during the process we have that this is during the in the literature for this reaction then you might have some amount of conversion mentioned, selectivity and yield, but nobody will mention that what are the impurities generated. So that is the role of a process engineer to understand what is the impurity. So first, let us go through some basics that conversion. Now, conversion is subjected to the limiting reactant. It is the ratio of the amount of the limiting reactant consumed in the reaction to the amount of the limiting reactant fed to the reaction. Then we have selectivity. Selectivity is the amount of the limiting reactant consumed for product formation. So what amount of product is formed from the limiting reaction divided by amount of limiting reactant totally consumed, because the limiting reactant will not only form product, it will form some impurities as well. So you need to have an idea what is the part of the what moles of the reactant are getting converted into the impurities. And last is yield, that is product formed in the reaction, that is actual product formed in the reaction to the divided by the product that could have formed. So it is the ratio. So all these ratios are always going to be less than one. So after you have an idea that that your chemical reaction, what all the compounds are generated in the chemical reaction, you should have an idea of what are the physical properties. Now to make you understand, I will put more stress on these physical properties, because I will give you an example that, for example, there is a small kid who is trying to learn a language. So what does he start with? They start with some alphabets. They start learning some alphabets. Once they learn the alphabets, they start combining these two alphabets to make small words. Then they start combining three alphabets to make a bigger word. And then they start to frame as sentences. And then they start to understand the sentences. So here also, whatever properties I'll be showing you is like an alphabet to your process. Once you understand your reactants, products, solvents, catalysts completely, you should know what properties they possess. So it completely acts as an alphabet for the process engineer. So they have an idea for what chemical they are handling, how it is to be handled, and why. And there are specific chemicals that needs to be handled in a specific way. So if you don't have these properties in your hand, then it's like you are like a blind person with an open eye. Because if, for example, I'll just give an example of that. It's a Grignard reagent. You are dealing with a Grignard reagent, but you don't know that Grignard reagent, if small amount of water gets into Grignard reagent, is going to go into runaway reaction. So you should make sure that such scenario does not occur in the industry. But that will only give you an idea when you have the physical properties of each and every compound together. No matter if there are impurities, if impurities are only 1%, but you should know what is the physical properties of or impurities. Because sometimes I have experienced in my past job that even 0.3% impurity in the effluent has caused a fire in the industry. So I have seen that even small percentage of impurities can create a disaster. Obviously, there was no casualty, but yes, there was a fire and it was in the effluent. So you need to know your chemicals well. So I have divided the properties into three parts. First is the basic properties. So for each and every compound, you should know your CAS number, chemical formula, molecular formula. So all this can be easily available from the literature or internet. The second most is the most important, which is the thermophysical property. Now this all the properties will define your products, because all the properties mentioned over here are somewhere or the other are going to be used in your calculation. Now, but there are some, for example, when you have very easy and easily data is available, that is not common compound. For example, even if I give an example of methanol, for example, methanol is a very common common compound. Hello, can you hear me? It's showing poor internet connection.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, okay. Because here is something pop-up calling, it is showing poor internet connection. Okay, no problem. So for example, you have a methanol. Now everybody knows that methanol has a boiling point of 64.8 degrees Celsius. But if in a process where methanol is being used as a methanol vapor in a fixed bed process, and methanol and the reaction temperature is 300 degrees Celsius, so how are you going to evaluate the density, viscosity, specific heat of methanol at 300 degrees Celsius? Because methanol will be in vapor form. So if you have a property apart from your process temperature, process condition, then it's not going to serve the purpose. You should have the properties. Okay, if you have properties at the ambient condition, is fine. But as well as you should have properties, this thermophysical data for the process condition as well. Because your Reynolds number, Prandtl number, Nusselt number, everything is going to be defined by the thermophysical properties at your process condition. So evaluation of these properties becomes very important. Because if you have an error while designing or while evaluating this property, your designing is not going to be proper. Because like heat of formation, density, viscosity, specific heat, latent heat of vaporization, these all things are being used for your designing equation. Even I mentioned your critical temperature, pressure, and volume. So if the data is not available in the literature, and even if the data is not available, right now we have many simulation software like Aspen, ChemCAD, but there are few compounds, because I have worked in the agrochemical industry where in my 7 years of career, apart from the common solvents like methanol, toluene, acetone, I have dealt with such a rigorous chemistry where the compounds were involving phosphorus chloro-based compound, phosphorus oxygen chlorine-based compound, phosphorus sulfur-based compounds, whose data is even not available in Aspen. There is no literature survey for such compounds. So how are you going to evaluate? When you go to the industry, there are thumb rules. Okay, that if you have an organic compound, assume specific heat 0.5. That's it. And water rahega, so you assume the specific heat as 1. But 0.5 does not work every time. You should know your compound well, because this is a thumb rule. The thumb rule has been designed based on some factor of safety. But when you are dealing with some critical chemistry, so you, from safety point of view, you should know what is the exact value of your compounds. Because these values are going to be used in your designing equations. And designing is just a mathematical equation. When you have these properties in your hand, it's just a mathematical calculation. And you are going to get some value. And based on that, you are going to design your equipment. But whether that equipment will work or no, that completely depends upon this thermophysical properties. So even the critical temperature, pressure, volume is also important, because I will give you some reference where there are equation which are limited to the critical temperature, pressure, and volume. Even in the literature, you will get empirical equations to calculate the critical temperature, pressure, and volume for each and every compound. It just, you need to hunt for the right equation. I will be giving you the references. I have 5-6 references I have in the subsequent slides. So I will share with you also. So this is most important part of the process engineer, because if you don't have the physical properties, proper values in your hand, you are anyways going to have a disaster in the plant while designing. And then the third is the process safety properties. So basically this you will get from the MSDS. So from process engineering point of view, it's very important to learn and read the MSDS, because these properties are mentioned over there, the LD50, LD, oral, the derma inhalation. So based on this, these values are very much important when you are doing HAZOP processes in your plant for the designing. So in one line that you should have your proper physical properties of each and every compound, because this is going to define your process. So these are the following references which I am still using for my calculations. There are in Paris edition 7th and 8th edition, you can find many equations, RC volume 6. So what I do usually, that when I need to evaluate, for example, a viscosity at viscosity of an organic compound at higher temperature. So you take any of this, solve any three equations, and if you solve it properly, the error in this equation are marginal, like hardly maximum 3% error would be there. So if you have this thermophysical properties properly, then you can evaluate the other design equations very comfortably. So you can use this. There are many other literatures available in the industry to use, but this is the most common, because I think this some of the equations in the latest version of SPEN, I think has also been designed based on these equations to evaluate the thermophysical properties. But in most of the cases, like in agrochemicals, where we are dealing with the phosphorus based compound, still there are no such compounds available in SPEN. So you can use this reference to have an idea of the thermophysical properties. So once you are done with the thermophysical properties, main job of the process engineer is to make the compatibility chart. Now this compatibility chart you can see on the outside of the plant, because when you enter a plant, there will be a chart showing in different colors, like yellow, green, white, red. So it shows what is the compatibility of the following compound with the rest of the compound. So for example, reactant A and B, they are reactive, so they are non-compatible with each other unless and until they meet in the process condition. Apart from that, they might degrade, they might create an explosion, we don't know. So they are not compatible. Similarly, reactant A with solvent, it's compatible. Even if they mix accidentally or there is cross-mixing of solvents and the reactant A, then nothing is going to happen. So this chart will define how the entire reaction is going to work. What is compatible, what is not compatible, and how to do what. And so, just what is the purpose of this compatibility chart? So the compatibility chart will completely rely on lab experimentation, because most of the time the data is not available in literature. So you will have to evaluate this compatibility chart based on the lab experimentation, if at ambient condition, and if possible, if the situation demands, you need to do it at the reaction condition as well. If for common compounds, authentic data is available in the literature or from the internet, but that from internet also you should have some authentic source. So you can use the data as a reference. This compatibility chart is basically used to design the storage in the plant as well as tank farm to have an adequate safety precautions. Also, this will give you the knowledge regarding the compatibility of each and every chemicals with one another, and to have a necessary safety measure if non-compatible mixture gets mixed with the other compound accidentally. Because when, for example, if there is some leakage and it gets mixed, or there's cross-mixing in the plant, so what will be the impact? We are not talking on the yield or purity, but what will be the impact from a safety point of view? So that needs to be addressed in this compatibility chart. And moreover, it will help if you have done this, the lab trials, then it will help you to avoid any unwanted emergencies. So after this, once you are through with your properties and compatibility chart, let's have a look on some aspects of byproducts and impurities. Sometimes byproducts are also been considered as an impurity. They are overlooked as an impurity because they do not add any value to the product. But yes, they both are different from each other, because byproducts are always produced stoichiometrically in the reaction, whereas impurities can be generated by side reaction, or it can be a product from a degradation reaction of the reactant or the product once after it's formed. Byproducts can sometimes add value addition to your costing, because you can get some valuable compounds which you can extract has a sellable value, market value, or you can use the same thing in your some other process. But when you have an impurity, it is always going to have a cost impact because it lowers the yield as it consumes your reactant and contributes to the effluent treatment plant. Now, for example, if you have an impurity which has a calorific value more than 4,000 kilocalories per kg, then it is considered as an organic impurity and it cannot be treated in the effluent treatment plant. So it has to be incinerated. And once it is incinerated, you might get some solid mass, which is landfill. So the incineration cost is approximately 25 rupees per kg. And if your impurity has a calorific value less than 4,000 kilocalories per kg, then it can be treated in effluent treatment plant. Because when an effluent treatment plant is designed, it has a particular load to handle the COD and BODs. So based on that, these values are defined. So this can be treated in effluent treatment plant, and the effluent treatment plant are normally in the range of 2 to 3 rupees per kg. If you have some gases generated during the process, then you cannot just vent off the gas directly into the atmosphere. You need to have a sufficient scrubbing system to dispose of the gas. Basically, the byproducts are the known compounds. You know what is being formed. For example, now if you take a condensation reaction, you know that two molecules are going to get condense and one mole of water is going to be formed. So water is a byproduct. So you know what is your byproduct. Impurities, mostly they are unknown. If you have selectivity of, for example, you can say 98%. So you can assume that 2% impurity is being generated, but you don't have an idea what these 2% are. It can be anything, organic, inorganic, acids, base, anything. So you need to identify what are your impurities. So because if you have this data that what is your impurity, then you can have an interaction parameter when you design a distillation column, whether or other for the other purification processes. Now to stop the byproduct formation, you need to change the chemistry. If you think that this byproduct which is forming in the reaction is not giving you any value, you can just simply change the chemistry. But to change the suppress the impurity formation or to eliminate the impurities, you can simply do a trial and error by changing the reaction condition. For example, if the reaction is being done at a pressure of 1 bar, so you can just increase the pressure, lower the pressure, and keep the temperature constant, and then once you find an optimum pressure, then you can vary the temperature to check the impact of the impurities. Because impurities have an impact with the temperature. So lowering the temperature might suppress the impurity sometimes, but not always, because if you lower the temperature, then the reaction rate constant will also go down. So you have to make sure that to reduce the impurity, you do not increase the batch cycle time. Now, example of byproducts, suppose if you are carrying out a decarboxylation reaction where carbon dioxide is generated stoichiometrically. So you cannot just vent off this into the atmosphere directly. So what you can do as a process engineer, you can design a scrubbing system with a caustic soda solution. You scrub this carbon dioxide into the caustic soda solution. You will have a solution, because carbon dioxide is a weak acid, and caustic is a strong base. So it is an acid-base reaction, and it will readily form, instantaneously form sodium bicarbonate solution, which is sellable in the market as well, or you can use in some different process in your plant. But for impurities, since it is generated in very small quantities, isolating impurity, even the sometimes impurities are formed, but sometimes it is a valuable product as well. But isolating such small quantities is always a tedious task, because for example, if you have a batch of 10 tons, 10,000 kg, and your impurities are hardly 1%. So it is going to be very difficult to isolate 100 kg from a batch of 10,000 kg. So rather than extracting it or isolating it, it's better to treat it as an effluent. So now once we are done the differentiate, now let us have some idea on what impurities are. So once you know that your system, your reaction has some impurities, then your focus should be when it is formed and how it is formed. So answer for the when it is formed is you will have to generate reaction kinetics for it. So once you do the reaction kinetics, you will get an idea when it is forming, and how it is formed. So once you have the structure of the impurities, then you can have some assumption that it might be coming from the reactant or the product or some impurities generated during the reaction. But it will be combination of your product and byproduct, product and reactant, because this product and reactant also might react to generate impurities. And the third and the last one is, which people mostly overlook in the industry, that whether the impurity is coming from the raw material itself. Because sometimes we assume that raw material is 100% pure, but it is not pure. It might be 99%, 98%. So is the impurity, is this 2% impurity coming from the raw material itself? And if this impurity is like an inert impurity having no impact on the reaction chemistry, then no need to bother for it. But if it might have impact on the chemistry, so then it's better to eliminate in the raw material itself and purify the raw material and then use it for the reaction. So now once you have the impurity, how are you going to identify it? Because you need to know the structure, and based on the structure, you will know what is the physical properties. So GC mass, there are tests available with the GC gas chromatography mass. So you will get a molecular weight identification for the impurity. Similarly, if you want to know the molecular structure of your impurities, then you can do NMR studies. Then you need to understand what is the impact of impurity on the product formation. Because sometimes some impurities are so rigid that they might poison your catalyst. So your catalyst activity might go down. For example, when you are using a heavy metal catalyst like gold or platinum based catalyst, you tend to use this catalyst at least for 50 cycles, 100 cycles, 110 cycles. But if you are generating that impurity that is poisoning your catalyst and you are not able to use that catalyst for 100 cycles, and instead of the 100 cycles, the catalyst is being poisoned in, you can say, by 10 cycles, that has a cost impact on your when catalyst contribution is calculated. So you need to make sure that whether these impurities are having impact, impact these impurities are having on the product as well as the catalyst. Now, can the impurity formation be minimized or avoided? This needs to be, as in the last slide we saw, that we can change the process condition to check whether the impurities can be minimized or whether it can be avoided. And can the impurity be converted into some value-added products? Now, it depends upon the costing. Now, for example, if you are using some heavy metals which needs to be extracted, because you cannot just dump in the effluent. So what people do in the industry, for example, they store this impurity for 10 batch or 20 by 30 batches together. And once they have a substantial volume, then they treat it as a separate processing unit. So if you have something heavy metals like gold or something platinum needs to be extracted, then this is feasible. Otherwise, wasting time behind small quantities of impurities is not required. So once you know what are your reactants, what are your products, what are your byproducts, what are your impurities, then it's time for, so now as a process engineer, you are able to define the entire reaction. You know what are your compounds, byproducts, and what is your unreacted raw material available. So based on that, you need to do a mass balance of based on 1,000 gram of product, 1 kg of product. Now, why 1 kg of product? We could have done mass balance on limiting reactant as well. But when you do a project on commercial level, everything will be defined as rupees per kg of product. So it is always better for a process engineer to use this language. Always define your process per kg of product. So when you have a process, so when you have a metal balance of based on the 1,000 gram of product or 1 kg of the product, so if you have a, for example, you have a byproduct forming approximately 150 grams during the reaction. So if during the, so what is the impact? So impact or the consumption ratio, you can say that the byproduct is approximately 0.15 kg per kg of your product. So whatever amount of product is formed, you multiply it by 0.15, it will be a byproduct. Similarly, you will have ratios for your reactant, limiting reactant impurities, and the unreacted reactant as well. So this is very much important to have a very precise and accurate mass balance, because based on this mass balance, you are going to design a scale-up process. So this mass balance and the consumption ratio will give you the amount of the raw materials required per kg of the product. So for raw material calculation, this is very much essential. So you know that for 1 kg of the product, what is the reactant and limiting reactant required? So what will be the ratio? You just multiply it by the cost and you will have the raw material costing. Similarly, for the effluent generated, so you can easily bifurcate that what effluent is being vented into the atmosphere per kg of the product, what is the effluent discharge into the ETP per kg of the product, and what material is incinerated and landfilled per kg of the product. So based on this, you will have a bifurcation for each and every effluent and their impact of costing on the final product. Amount of impurities generated per kg of the product, so you know what amount of the raw material you are losing in impurities, because this is straight away loss for us. And when you have a precise mass balance, it gives you an exact composition for the crude product for further processing. Now, for example, after this product is formed, this might be subjected to a distillation column. So this will become your feed to a distillation column. So if you don't do this precise mass balance over here, you might have to do in distillation process. So this completes your complete reaction for the mass balance. So you should have an idea of what amount is being produced per kg of a product. And for if you have this mass balance, then for scaling up, for example, you have this 1 kg mass balance, you want to design for a 10,000 kg, you have a factor of 10,000, multiply everything by 10,000, you will get a plant mass balance, a commercial plant mass balance. So this is an important aspect from a process engineering point of view. So first part is evaluating the physical properties, compatibility chart, and then this is mass balance with the consumption ratio. Because this consumption ratio is only considered for the costing, for raw material costing processes. Then comes to an interesting part, the heat of reaction. Now everybody knows how to evaluate the heat of reaction. It is nothing but a summation of heat of formation of the on the product side minus heat of formation of the on the reactant side. But this should also be defined as kilocalorie per kg of product. A positive value means it's an endothermic reaction, means heat is to be given to maintain the reaction temperature, and negative value means exothermic process. Now, in the literature, you are going to find values of heat of formation at 25 degrees Celsius, that is 290 degrees Kelvin. But suppose if your reaction is, as I told you, for example, reaction is carried out at 100 degrees or 300 degrees, then how are you going to evaluate heat of formation for every compound at your reaction condition? So we need to use this equation. So this is heat of formation at reaction temperature is equal to heat of formation at 298 degrees Kelvin, that is 25 degrees Celsius, because these values are available in the literature, plus Cp into dt. The dt is from 25 degrees to your reaction temperature. So you have, for example, you have A, B, C, D. So you have to evaluate heat of formation for A, B, C, D using this equation. And then you need to do the summation and the subtraction to get the exact value of heat of reaction at your reaction temperature. Now, this part, which we call as adiabatic condition, where in case of exothermic reaction, we have adiabatic temperature rise. And in terms of endothermic reaction, we can calculate adiabatic temperature fall. Now, what exactly this adiabatic temperature rise is? Now, for example, assume a situation in the plant that it's a batch reaction. You have added both the reactant. If you have a catalyst, you have added catalyst and everything, solvents has been added. And you start the reaction. Once you start the reaction, exotherm is generated. So to control the exotherm, to maintain the constant reaction temperature, you will have a coolant supply in the jacket or the internal coil. Now suppose your cooling fails, then what will happen? In absence of cooling, exotherm will generate and it will start increasing your reaction temperature. So in case of an exotherm reaction, we might see an adiabatic temperature rise. So in this condition, a process engineer should know what is the maximum temperature rise possible in the reaction when such condition arises. So why this is important? Because now, for example, if the reaction is to be carried out at 80 degrees Celsius. But because of the adiabatic temperature rise, you know as a process engineer that the adiabatic temperature rise for the process based on the exothermicity is 40 degrees. So there might be a chance that your reaction, if in case of coolant failure, your reaction might from 80 degrees start rising gradually and reach 120 degrees Celsius. So when you have this reaction condition at 120 degrees Celsius, you need to evaluate that what will be your yield? Will the product start degrading? What will be the impact on impurities? Because once the temperature start rising, impurities might start building up inside the reactor. Or you need to evaluate the condition that in the adiabatic temperature rise condition, whether the reaction is going to go in a runaway condition. So because you don't have sufficient coolant to remove the exotherm. So if there are chances, quite possibility that the reaction might enter a runaway zone. So you need to evaluate this from a process engineering point of view. This I term it as this as a hidden thing. This is never defined in the process. But as a process engineer, you need to look into this aspect that if adiabatic temperature rise is seen, then what is the impact from safety point of view? Because yield point of view, you might lose some yield, you might lose some compound, but whether that increase in the temperature from safety point of view should not be disastrous, because there are few points to remember. Every 10 degree rise, this is a thumb rule, every 10 degrees rise in temperature, your reaction rate constant doubles. So you need to have an idea that what will be the impact for this rise in temperature. Because once your rate constant starts doubling, means your exotherm is going to generate fast. So that is a condition where it might enter a runaway zone. So this is what I explained you, that if the adiabatic temperature rises 40 degrees, then what will be the impact on reaction? Not only from yield point of view, but from safety point of view. And will it go runaway condition? So everything has to be evaluated in the lab by the process engineer. So to have a proper and safe, foolproof, what we say, a foolproof design. So types of reaction. Now, basically, we have CSTRs and PFR. So the reactions that are mass transfer control and thermodynamically controlled reaction, we usually prefer a CSTR or batch reactors, because this type of reaction requires a longer residence time. But when we have heat transfer controlled reaction, where the reactions are very instantaneous, they are very, very fast reaction, or they require very low residence time, or heat transfer area providing is critical because it is a tremendously exothermic reaction, or product degradation might take place at the reaction temperature if they remains into the reactant system for a longer period of time. So heat sensitive, I mean to say. So under this condition, you can use a plug flow reactor, because plug flow reactor, how it works in a continual mode. Once the reactant comes into contact, product is formed and it moves ahead. So product does not get a chance to react back with the reactant. So this is how we define CSTR. So there are specific reactions which can be done in CSTRs, and there are specific reactions which can be done in PFRs. So now let's get into the reaction kinetics. Now this is a very simple curve. Reaction kinetic data, usually we like how we have done in our engineering days, usually we have when we do reaction kinetics, we just think that okay, this curve is generated with some data, and then we again make some choose five six points, get the slope, and make another plot which is a straight line, the slope, we calculate the slope, we calculate the intercept, and we get the order of the reaction and the rate constant. But this curve is not subjected to only identifying what is the order of the reaction and the rate constant. What data you can generate from it, we'll see in the subsiding slides. Now, for example, if your rate constant is more than one, then preferably you can go for PFRs, because you require very low, less residence time. And if your rate constant is greater less than one, then you preferably require a CSTR, because you require longer residence time. Now, from this reaction kinetic curve, you can have a data at what rate the product is forming with respect to time. Also, impurity formation, once you identify the impurity along with the kinetics curve which you generate for the product formation, you can also have the same thing done for your impurity formation. So you will have an idea when the impurity is forming and under what condition it is forming. Because some impurities might form after a particular concentration, for example, a mononitrobenzene reaction. So when nitration reaction takes place, specifically for mononitrobenzene, what the based on the reaction kinetics data, it shows that after 40% mononitrobenzene is formed inside the reaction mass, then the impurity of dinitrobenzene starts. And once dinitrobenzene starts, it readily reacts with the nitric acid in the reaction and converts itself into trinitrobenzene. But now, when we have a trinitro compound, it's very dangerous because it might explode some of the other time. So why to have such condition? So based on what they do in the mononitrobenzene process, that they don't allow the reaction to go further 40%. Once they're done with the 40%, they stop, they terminate the reaction, they do their purification process and go further. So there is no chance of generating the impurities. So based on some critical chemistries, you should have a precise reaction kinetics data to make sure that you do not generate some explosive compounds, because trinitro compounds are really difficult to handle in at larger scales. So, just a moment. So now let's understand what data you can generate from the reaction kinetics curve. So based on the time for a particular, once you have done the sampling, you know the concentration moles per liter of the reactant, or you can generate what is the product formation. You can have an idea what conversion is being done at a particular time, or what product is formed and how the product is formed during the course of the reaction. So you can see that you can understand that from in the first 20 minutes, the reaction is very fast. It's really active in that first 20 minutes, because approximately 1866 kg product is formed. But during the course of the time, the reaction subsides, and you can see in the last sample that in 1 hour, only 93 kg of product is formed. So based on this, you have an idea that how the product is being formed during the course of the process. So let's estimate some the cooling capacity based on the kinetics curve. So the product form is approximately 9,870 kgs per batch. Assume that heat of reaction is minus 122 kilocalories per kg of the product. So the total exothermicity formed per batch is approximately 12 lakhs kilocalories per batch. And reaction time is 10 hours per batch. So we can take that average exothermicity to be removed is approximately 120,000 kilocalories per hour. So based on this average exothermicity value, we can just do Q is equal to MCP delta T, where we are using cooling water as a utility, and the CP of water is 1, delta T we can take 7. So based on this calculation, we can get the cooling capacity for the process. So now I have one question for you all, that can we take the above values for the designing purpose? Is this calculation accurate, or still some fine tuning is required with this calculation? Anyone can answer me? Hello?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, we need to take the above values because the heat transfer might not be that efficient.
Okay.
In the jacket or the cooling coils.
So we should consider this value?
I think we should take some higher value by doing the heat transfer calculation.
No, but what higher value?
Sir, depending upon the heat transfer coefficient of the jacket or cooling coil.
No, we have not yet reached that stage for designing the whole heat transfer coefficient. We are just dealing with the exothermicity. It's just based on this exothermicity, I have calculated some cooling capacity. So is it sufficient enough, or we need, okay, if you say, okay, I can tell you, okay, we'll take a factor of safety of 15% and go ahead. Is it okay?
Yes, I think.
Any other guesses? Okay, someone wrote we can take this value, ideal value. Okay. Okay, any other guesses? Or should I go ahead? Okay, I'm getting some feedback from suggestions on the chat box. We need to consider byproduct and impure. No, this average value is a heat of formation. So when you do heat of reaction, you have considered the product side and the reactant side. So this what value I'm showing you of my 120,000 average value is considering byproduct, impurity, everything. Okay, anyways, we'll go further. No, you cannot take this values. If you take this values, you might not be your reactor, your cooling, this is not a sufficient cooling capacity. I'll show you how. Now I have shown you the kinetic curve. Now combine this kinetic curve with exothermicity. Now you know that in the first 20 minutes, approximately 18,067 kg of product is formed. You multiply this with your heat of reaction. So you will get a value of that exothermicity to be removed is approximately 227,000 kilocalories. So during the course of the next 20 minutes, that is from the second one, the product form is 14,067 kilos. Multiplied by your exothermicity, that is 122 kilocalories, and you see the difference. It is approximately difference of 50,000 kilocalories. So during the course of the reaction, after a particular time, the reaction starts subsiding. So you check the first sample, you check the last sample. The first sample, exothermicity removed in the first 20 minutes, is 227,000 kilocalories. But for the last sample, in 1 hour, you can check 540 to 600 minutes, it's 1 hour. In 1 hour, exothermicity removed is approximately 11,000 kilocalories. So almost 20 times the difference from the first sample. Okay, that's why I told in the beginning that a kinetic data is one of the fantastic data process engineers can have. And if you have an exact and a precise kinetic data, you can evaluate. So based on this, now you need to know what is your cooling capacity. So you know what is your peak load. So you need to design your peak utility load such that you should have the turndown ratio. So based on this, with respect to time, you know now what Q, that is exothermicity, is to be handled. So based on that, you do MCP delta T, you will get what kg of coolant is required. Right here, I have considered water as a coolant. You divide it by 3024, you will get TR. So you know that in the first 20 minutes, you will require approximately 11 TR of coolant. And the last sample will require only 0.5 TR of the coolant. But usually in the plant, they don't keep on changing this TR, the cooling capacity on every sampling basis. Or now you need to define that, okay, that like now how we decide that the average value is 5.686. So what they do, where is 5.686 here? After 2 hours, you can turn down the ratio from 11 to 5.6. And because this TR value, the average TR value, and the heat generated is lower than the average coolant. So once you surpass this zone, when you have a maximum heat of generation during the reaction, then you can keep this value. For the first four samples, you cannot keep this value because your average load, because we took an average value. Reaction curve is an exponential curve, not a straight line curve passing through origin. So that is a big difference. So you need to understand your curves, your this kinetic curve very well, because kinetics is an exponential curve, not a straight line curve. So based on this, you know what is the cooling capacity and cooling capacity required. And for every sample, you know what will be the adiabatic temperature rise. So you might, this, if you use a very sophisticated software like S-Pen or ChemCAD, the same data is generated in the S-Pen. So a process engineer, whether you have a S-Pen or any other similar software you have or you don't have, but even if you have a good vision for the process, how you can avoid having disaster in the plant, you can generate this data. You don't require any software because this simulation softwares are just a software. You put any value to, you give any value as an input to them, they're going to give you some value as an output. So whether that value is relevant or not, that is up to you as a process engineer to understand whether this value is correct or not, whether this has to be considered for designing or not. So let's just have a comparison of the first and the last sample. So the product form is first, for the first 20 minutes is approximately 1870 kilograms, whereas in the last sample, that is in the last 60 minutes, product form is only 93 kilo. So heat of reaction based on the product form is approximately 227,000 in 20 minutes, or if I multiply it by 3, it will get in kilocalories per hour. Similarly, for the last sample, the heat of reaction is 11,000 kilocalories per hour. So what factor you are lagging? For example, for the first sample, you have designed for a exothermicity of 127,000, but your actual heat removal should be 680,000. So the factor is 5.6. This means that the reaction which was supposed to get completed in 20 minutes will now take a time of 114 minutes because you don't have sufficient cooling capacity or the area to remove this heat. So you will have to slow down the reaction. Now, since it's a batch reaction, then you might have to convert it into semi-batch reaction to control the exotherm. Because if it's a batch reaction, if this is the reaction conditions, and if this is the exotherm generated, then you might lose your yield and selectivity, everything. So you might have to convert it into the semi-batch process to control the exotherm. Now for the last sample, now since the ratio is less than one, that doesn't mean since you are providing an extra cooling to the last to the last 1 hour, so the reaction will complete in 6 minutes. No, this is not the case. It will require this 93 kg based on the kinetics curve, this 93 kg will require 60 minutes only, no matter you supply the cooling duty more than the desired one. So your peak load comes to around 10.76 TR. So initial 3-4 samples, unless and until your TR load comes down to the average load, till that time you need to control this exotherm. So what are the consequences? Now, for example, if you have designed the heat transfer area for a reactor with an average load, then what will happen? Your normal process, which was supposed to complete in 10 hours, might take 14.6 hours. So it's straight 4.6 hours lost per batch. So for example, if you have decided to have 2 batches per day, but if you're losing 4.5 hours per batch, then you're not going to complete 2 batches per day. So eventually there will be production delay or compromise in the product quantity. So if you don't have this calculations properly, you might lose on productivity, and that is a cost to the company. There are things how you can overcome this. So now, for example, you have designed an equipment with an average load. So now you need to make sure that whatever the heat is generated, you need to remove within this periphery only. So what you can do, you can change over the utility from cooling water to chilled brine, but you should also understand the dynamics that the cost would increase. So because utility cost of the cooling water is approximately 2.2 rupees per TR, but for chilled brine is approximately somewhere in between 22 to 27 rupees per TR. So is the product that much capable to handle this increase in the load of the costing? Or you might have to provide an external heat exchanger so that that heat load is removed in the heat exchanger and then again recirculated back inside the reactor. But here again, from safety point of view, you will have to understand and to evaluate that the reaction mass, pumping that reaction mass at that reaction temperature, which may be 80 degrees, 100 degrees, whatever, is it feasible? Is it feasible to pump from safety point of view? So that has to be evaluated because you cannot compromise on quality. And second one is, as I told you, that change in the dosing pattern. You need, if it's batch process, you need to convert it in a semi-batch process, or if it's an already a semi-batch process where a reactant A is taken in the bottom of the reactor, heated to a reaction temperature, and then a reactant B is added. So you might have to reverse it. You might have to take the reactant B inside the reactor, heat it, and then start adding the reactant A and check. But this has to be done in the lab before trying into the plant. So once, because you need to check on yield, purity, conversion, what impurities it is forming. So everything has to be checked in the lab before changing the dosing pattern. So whatever ways we learn to overcome the consequences have an additional cost impact. So you need to understand whether you are implementing all the threes together or you are implementing any one of this. So you need to make sure on techno-commercial ground that whether economic point of view it is feasible or no, or it is from economic point of view, let's have a new reactor. So you need to evaluate both the conditions from a process engineer point of view. So what have we learned from the kinetic curve? Kinetic curve is not subjected to a rate constant or order of reaction. It gives an idea that what is the conversion of the reactant with respect to time. It gives you an idea what is the product, byproduct and impurities formation with respect to time. Also, what is the importance of heat of reaction with respect to time and how you can evaluate the heat load with respect to time. What are your maximum minimum flow rates for the utility with respect to corresponding time? And the most important, it is what is your adiabatic temperature rise and fall with respect to time. I have not yet taken the viscosity curve, but you can, when you are doing a lab study of a plant and when there is a drastic change in the viscosity, what you can do, you can, when you are sampling, you can check the viscosity at the process condition for every samples and you can generate the curve. It might be a linear straight line, or it might be a curve, because in most of the reaction, the viscosity does not change drastically, because you might start with 1 centipoise and you might end with a 3 centipoise viscosity. But there are few reactions where there's a drastic change in the viscosity. So at that point of time, you need to have this data as well. So sampling remains the same, only you need to generate the data for viscosity with respect to time. Because I have deal with one reaction in my previous job where we were dealing with an exothermic reaction. So initially, the viscosity of the reaction mass was approximately 1.2-1.5 centipoise. But during the course of the time when the reaction proceeds and we simultaneously do solvent recovery, also the end reaction viscosity was 1,30,000 centipoise, more than that. So we started with approximately 1 centipoise and we ended with 1,30,000 centipoise. So we have generated the curve for the viscosity with respect to time. So we had an idea that after 60 or 70% of the reaction is done with the solvent recovery, there is sharp rise in the viscosity. So that is the point when we need to understand that how the reactor and the stirrer is going to behave, because the stirrer is going to be designed for the maximum viscosity and not the lowest viscosity. So always keep in mind that viscosity is very important, not only from designing stirring point of view, but also from designing the heat transfer process also, because viscosity is an important, because when you require viscosity for calculating Reynolds number, so these are defining the viscosity is going to define your heat transfer phenomena also. So summarizing what data you can generate from the reaction kinetics. So once you have the kinetic curve properly done, so you can have the entire dynamics of the reaction, what is happening during the course of the reaction, during the process. So for example, as I told that when you are doing a commissioning of the plant, you might ask, somebody might ask you a random question that what will be a reaction condition after 2 hours. So you know that I have highlighted that at 120 minute, that product, for what is the product formation, what is the conversion, what are the moles of reactant and product present in the reaction system, what is the heat removed, what is the current PR required, what is the adiabatic temperature rise. So everything you should have in a single paper. So this will make a life of a process engineer very simple. Now the reaction temperature is 80 degrees, and if your coolant fails, so what will be your adiabatic temperature rise? So you might reach a temperature of 126 maximum. So from safety point of view, for a process engineer, they should evaluate the following reaction at 126 degrees as well, to understand the safety point of view, then yield, purity, impurity formation. So everything has to be studied. So if sometimes, this might not happen every time in the plant, but sometimes it happens, so they can have safety precautions well before when such situation arises. So with this data, you can check that at the approximately 80% of the reactor, you can never go wrong, unless and until if your fabricator does some mistake or there is some mistake in the commissioning or something like that. But 80 to 90% data you have on your hand, and based on this, when you design a reaction reactor for a particular reaction, you can never go wrong. So we've completed one part of the reaction kinetics. Now let's go to the second part. That is the process parameters required to design the process vessel. So once you are done with the kinetics and the heat of reaction, you need to design the process vessel. So what are the important aspects you need to study? First is the vessel geometry, material of construction, jacket and internal coils, agitation, piping system, instrumentation, and external heating and cooling system if required, like I told you in the earlier case. So here, out of the seven aspects, I am going to cover the first three, because I cannot cover everything in a single presentation, because for only vessel agitation and baffle, I can give you entire presentation for vessel agitation, baffling, and stutter selection. So that we might cover sometime later. So vessel geometry. So basically your vessel is divided into three parts. It's a cylindrical vessel and dish ends on both the sides. Basically, the length and diameter ratio for the normal vessel configuration in the ratio of 1:1 to 1.5:1. So for normal reaction condition. But when you have a system where you need to maximize your heat transfer through jacket, or you have a sparging, you are sparging some gas into the system where you need to maximize the mass transfer of the gas into the liquid, you will require residence time. You require a larger residence time. So you need to make sure that your length to diameter ratio may vary from 2 to 4, depending on the situation or what you want to design. For a crystallizer, you might design a system where the ratio of L by D can be less than 1. So because you require precipitation or a settling of the solid at a faster rate. Now, selection of bottom dish for the process vessel. Sometimes, most of the time, process engineers overlook this because they believe that it's job of the project department. They will handle what they want to select. But project departments, the engineers in the project department completely depend upon the fabricator. They think that fabricator knows the process and they will design the bottom for the reactor. But you should, as a process engineer, you should know what is your process. For example, if you have a common reaction system, a normal reaction system under mild condition, then a torus pericycle dish can be used. But when you have dealing with a high pressure chemistry, like where the application of pressure is more than 20 bars, go for ellipsoidal dish. If you are going for more higher pressure reaction, that is above 100 bar, then go for hemispherical dish. And if you have a system for crystallization or where solids are being precipitated, just to reduce the residence time, you can use a conical end. And for an unpressurized storage vessel, you can use a flat bottom. So these are just thumb rules which you can select the bottom of the process vessel. Now heat transfer in agitated vessel. So now once you are done with the kinetics, we are done with the heat of reaction absorbency. Now we'll talk what are the factors that are going to affect the heat transfer in the agitated vessel. First is the physical properties of the reaction mass and the media in the jacket. That's why I was very precise on the thermophysical data, which I showed you in the beginning. So I was very much focusing on the physical properties. Then the vessel geometry. What is your length and the diameter of the reactor and all that stuff. Degree of agitation, whether the reaction is mild, agitated, moderate, or you require a rigorous agitation. So, and the type and the size of the agitator and the location of the agitator, that is the clearance from the bottom and clearance from the vessel wall. So everything, complete geometry is required for the for designing the heat transfer in agitated vessel. Now, this is a simple jacketed reactor. Now, during the reaction, we know that the reaction mass is going to remain at a constant temperature. So we can say that the reaction or the reactor is in the under isothermal condition. Now, if your jacket inlet temperature and the outlet temperature are same, then it is said that your jacket is also under an isothermal condition. So when you have a system where your jacket and the reactor are under isothermal condition, then your Q is defined by the equation Q is equal to UA into delta T. But if you have a situation where the inlet and the outlet temperature of the jacket are not equal to, are not same, then it is a non-isothermal condition for a jacket. So when you have a reactor under isothermal condition and a jacket under non-isothermal condition, then Q is evaluated as UA delta TNM. So here, under non-isothermal jacket condition, log mean temperature difference comes into picture. So I will not cover what exactly what, because we all know what, I'm assuming that everybody over here know what is the log mean temperature difference. So once this is done, how you are going to design a process particular for a plant, process designing for the reactor in the plant. So whenever you design a reactor, for example, don't design for 24 hours per day for a complete one cycle. You design it for 20 hours per day and keep 4 hours buffer time for an emergency breakdown. So how the operation is been divided. So first is you start with the charging of raw material. Now, but when it comes to charging, you need to define the physical properties of the material that is to be transferred by the pumps. Because sometimes you require to heat the raw material and then transfer. So because pumps are usually, for example, if you choose a centrifugal pump are basically designed for on the water basis. So you choose a capacity of 5 m³, but they are designed for water. Density is 1 and viscosity is 1. So, but if you want to pump a higher viscosity material, for example, like if your viscosity is 2, so you might not, even if a pump is working with a full capacity, you might not get a full capacity of 5 m³/h because the viscosity is changed. Because the pump is, the capacity of the pump is based on water, which is 5 m³/h. But now since you are pumping a higher viscosity, your pumping capacity is going to go down. So when you are selecting a pump, you need to know what is the physical properties of your compounds to be pumped. So this might increase your pumping time. Then the time required to attain the temperature, reaction temperature. So it completely depends upon how you select your utility flow rate, how you design, which we have seen earlier. Then the reaction time, it is going to completely defined by the reaction kinetics. If you have solvent, then if solvent recovery is there, then it completely depends upon the utility flow rate and the physical property of the actual reaction mass. Because earlier for charging, you have a specific raw material, so you know the properties. But now, when this recovery is being done, you should know the physical properties of your actual reaction mass. Because now your reaction mass will have your reactants, products, byproducts, impurities. Then cooling of reaction mass. So it again depends upon the utility flow rate and discharging of the crude mass for the further processing. So again, pump selection is to be done based on the physical properties of the compound. But here, one thing is to be kept in mind that whether cooling of the reaction mass is required or not. Because sometimes, suppose if your reaction is at 100 degrees, solvent curve is done. Now for further, the reaction mass is going to subject it to a distillation process. So in distillation process, again the reaction mass is going to get heated. So is cooling required there? If not, then don't cool directly, you can transfer. But during transferring, you should know the safe, as from safety point of view, I'll just show you that what is the flash point. If, for example, the flash point of the crude mass, which is to be transferred without heating, or sorry, without cooling, should be lower than the transferring temperature. So if your flash point is lower than the reaction temperature, then you cannot transfer it. So you need to understand the safety of transferring the material at higher temperature. So if flash point is an issue, so there might be a chance, because in pump, when it's pumping, cavitation might take place, and you know, there might be a chance of having a fire over there. So you need to make sure what is the flash point of your reaction mass before transferring it at higher temperatures. If your flash point is higher than your reaction temperature, then nothing to worry about. But if your flash point is lower than the reaction temperature, then you need to make sure that you are 10 degrees below your flash point and you transfer it. So basically, mistakes are been done in evaluating heating and cooling time. So when you have an isothermal jacket condition, so that is inlet and outlet jacket temperature almost constant, or the difference between inlet and outlet jacket temperature should be less than the 10% of the delta TLM. So what value of the log mean temperature difference, 10% should be. So if you encounter this situation, then you can, for heating and cooling, you can use this equation. And for non-isothermal condition, when the difference between the inlet and outlet jacket temperature is more than the 10% of delta TLM, you can use the following equation. So based on the jacket condition, the heating and cooling equations are defined. So this will give you an exact idea on how, what will be the time required for heating as well as cooling. Now, heat transfer area in the reactor. So basically, there are three aspects in heat transfer area. One is the available heat transfer area. Second is the required heat transfer area. And third one is the exposed heat transfer area. This is somewhat limited to a semi-batch reactor. So available heat transfer area is completely dependent on the geometry of the reactor. So what is physically available with you, what you have designed or what your fabricator has designed for you, will define the available heat transfer area. But your required heat transfer area is defined by the equation Q is equal to U A delta TLM, or area is equal to Q upon U into A delta TLM. So here you can accurately measure the delta TLM. You know what is your Q, but you need to define your U properly, because overall heat transfer coefficient is completely depend upon your thermophysical properties like viscosities, densities, specific heat. If you don't have these values accurately, you will not have overall heat transfer value proper. And if you don't have this value proper, you will not get the required area accurately. So you need to make sure that, again, I'm repeating, your thermophysical data should be very accurate for the designing purpose. So for satisfactory design, if your available area is more than the required area, then we can consider it as a safe design. Now for exposed heat transfer area, consider this as a semi-batch reactor. The orange is a reaction mass. You can consider it as a reactant A, which is already charged in the reactor. I have the jacket has been divided into two colors, red and blue. So blue is the currently exposed area. Because even though you will start the utility, your entire jacket is flooded with the utility, but your exposed area is effective area is only the blue part, because your reaction mass is subjected to this part of the jacket only. So now in semi-batch process, once you start the reaction, so after 1 hour, this will be your exposed surface area. After 2 hours of addition, 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours, and 6 hours. So once the addition is done, then you can, so in semi-batch process, your area will keep on changing until your addition gets complete. So you need to define when you design, you should know what is your exposed heat transfer area at a particular time. So as a process engineer, when you are working in the lab, you are basically using a glass reactor. So based on, when you do a lab study for kinetics, you can scale it up in the for the commercial plant reactor, but you cannot define the heat transfer phenomena appearing in the lab to appear same as in the plant, because in the plant you are going to use a stainless steel reactor, and in the lab you are using a glass reactor. So the thermal conductivity difference between glass and the stainless steel is approximately 15 times. So if you try to evaluate heat transfer based on your glass equipment in the lab, it is never going to be easy job, because the difference might be in the heat transfer constant. You might be have a difference of 15 times area, because thermal conductivity of stainless steel is 17 and the glass is 1.16. So you divide it, you will get a ratio of 14 point something. So approximately that will be the difference in the, that much time the difference will be in the heat transfer coefficients. So you need to evaluate accurately based on the MOC. Now let's come to the last part, the jacket and the internal coils. So what are the factors that are affecting the jackets and the internal coils? So first is the rate of heat transfer required, critical cooling duties and the exothermic which you need to control, whether the process is line, means you might have a glass line reactor, or for a corrosive chemistry, you will have a Hastelloy lining on this SS reactor. So this that also might affect the thermal conductivity and the cleanability of the process. So if you have a slurry in the process, so whether if the slurry get deposit in the reactor wall, this might also act as an additional resistance to the heat transfer. So what are different types of jackets available? First, the conventional jacket, the most commonly used because it's quite inexpensive. The clearance is between the jacket and the vessel wall is approximately 50 mm. Mostly glass line reactors are always being used by, we will find a conventional jacket on the glass line reactors. The only disadvantage is that they have a low heat transfer rate because their flow regime in the jacket is in the laminar zone. So for equal flow rates of the utility with different jackets, a conventional jacket gives the lowest heat transfer rates. So just because this is conventional jacket with the agitation nozzle. So just to increase the heat transfer rate, the circulating fluid inside the jacket is injected circumferentially inside the jacket through an agitation nozzle. But this increases the pumping cost. So you need to evaluate that is pumping cost justifiable for the increase in the heat transfer rate. Now conventional jackets with spiral baffle. So usually to increase the fluid velocity, they're incorporated with the baffles. Expansion is designed for high pressure circulating fluid. Then we have half pipe coil, or it is also called limpet coil. So construction is basically using the pipe of 2 to 4 inches and welding it on the outer surface of the vessel. The spacing between the two pipes are approximately 30 to 50 mm. They provide a high heat transfer area and they are suitable for a high pressure above 20 bar application. And the overall efficiency of the limpet coil or half pipe coil is approximately 95%. Now dimple jacket is basically constructed like a conventional jacket only, but they are plug welded on the outer vessel. So the presence of plug welded makes the jacket more sturdy and it gives us the freedom to use a lighter material. Now, if you consider a conventional jacket, so we'll have to make sure that the MOC of the jacket and the reactor should be same, because if you have a different different materials for jacket and the reactor, and if the thermal coefficient expansion is different, the difference is too large. So based on the temperature rise, there will be an expansion in the metal. So if there are two different source, different metals used for a jacket and the reactor, based on the thermal coefficient expansion, there might be a crack because they will not expand linearly because of the difference in the thermal coefficient. So basically for conventional type of jacket, we might use the same MOC as compared to the reactor. But since these dimple jackets are welded, they give us the freedom to use a lighter material because they provide more sturdiness to the jacket. Plug weld, it provides more turbulence, hence it generates enhanced heat transfer. And if you want to incorporate baffles for increase the fluid velocity, so baffles are also incorporated to increase the heat transfer area. And last is the internal coil. It can be used with and without the jacket, so it has an advantage. If you want to provide an additional heat transfer area, you can use this with and as an internal coil. But an internal coil has the highest heat transfer coefficient as compared to the other jackets. But the only limitation is that when you have an internal coil, you cannot provide the baffles inside the reactor. So, and the coil support areas are difficult to skin, difficult to clean. Because if you have a slurry-like, slurry-type substance in the reaction mass, they might get deposit and they might act as a hindrance in the heat transfer as an additional resistance. So, here I have summarized some equations which can be used to evaluate the inside heat transfer coefficient. So for a process vessel, the inside heat transfer coefficient is basically governed by the agitator type and depending on what Reynolds number it is providing. So based on the Reynolds number and the type of the agitator, here are some equations which can define the inside heat transfer coefficient. Similarly, the outside heat transfer coefficient is defined by what type of jackets you are going to use. And again, based on the Reynolds number in the jacket, the equations are defined. So you can check the different types of jacket has been covered up. So maximum equations have been summarized over here. This graph I have taken from Ludwig, which also says that for a common Reynolds number, you will the coil will have, that means the internal coil will have a higher heat transfer coefficient as compared to the jacket. So you need to select wisely whether you need require a jacket or you require a internal coil. And if you select an internal coil, make sure you will not have baffles inside the reactor so that turbulence will not get. But yes, based on your process, process demand, you can select coil as well as jacket. So now, for example, what we have gone through today, like evaluating the thermophysical properties, reaction kinetics, combination of heat transfer with the reaction kinetics, agitator designing, selection of the different type of jackets and all that stuff. So whatever I have covered, what can go wrong? So I'll just give you an example that if, for example, if you do not evaluate the physical properties, which is the most basic thing which you have not evaluated properly, then even if despite you have the best equation, the correct equation for designing, your designing will not be satisfactory because there will be error in calculating Reynolds number, Prandtl number, Nusselt number, and other factors as well. I'm just highlighting few over here. If you do not evaluate your viscosities properly, then there might be a problem with your stirrer designing. Then you might face a jacket internal coils for the reactor. Heat exchangers will not be designed properly. Even you might face problem in the distillation column, because in distillation during the course in the entire column, you will have some vapors, will have some liquid. So you need to evaluate the properties of the vapor and the liquid as well. So if you don't evaluate your physical properties properly, then you will have to compromise with your equipment designing, or it will be unsafe designing. So how to avoid this? So on the question mark, you can see there is a mentioned problem. I will not treat it as a problem. It's a challenge, because there is, in the process engineer's life, there is nothing called as problem. It's a challenge. So when you are designing a process, you need to think linearly. sorry, you don't require to think linearly. You don't have to think in a unidirectional, because if you think in one direction, you will find only one solution. Okay, so but that solution needs to be evaluated on thermophysical, thermoeconomical, techno-commercial ground, whether that solution is feasible or not. So a process engineer should always think in a lateral manner, in a parallel way. So instead of having a so a pro, what will happen that you will have more than one solution. So you will have an option to choose the best solution for your process. So to avoid any disaster while designing the process. So always have an options open for thinking. Don't think in unidirection, in one direction, because there might be a situation where people might tell you that this is not feasible, you cannot do this, you cannot do that. Don't think that it is the end of the world. Start thinking out of the box, start thinking in a parallel manner, get maximum solutions, and you will find a solution. Because I myself have designed some critical reactors, distillation columns, which were, I myself have never imagined that this can be done. But yes, when you think laterally, you find more than one solution. So when you have more than one solution, you have an option to choose the best one. And as I told you in the beginning, that process engineers should have the ability to think out of the box. I will not explain much. I will just show you two figures, and the figures are more elaborative. So you will get an idea what you will get an idea what I'm trying to convey. Everybody has solved this puzzle in their school days. The target is to reach A to B. So you can, in the first picture on the left side, you see that you can go zigzag up, down, and finally, after taking too much of trouble, you reach the target B. But when you as a process engineer start thinking laterally, why to have so much trouble? Why not go out of the box from A to B? Target is to reach A to B, no matter what comes over. This should be the attitude of the process engineer. Kuch bhi ho jai, har nahi manna hai. No taking extra effort. You can directly go to A to B out of the box. This is a second picture where you can see we must have solved this puzzle. So what out of the box, and you win the situation. You make that zero out of the box and you have won the situation. So what does it say? That vertical thinking will give you a joy of logic, a gift of logic, but the lateral thinking will give you a gift of creativity. And that is what required from a process engineer, because process engineers will have to think with creativity. If you have creativity in thinking, you can crack any process. So what should be the mantra for the process engineer? Failure comes and go, accept it. But failure is not the opposite of success. It is a part of success. So you will have an idea that under what condition the reaction is going to fail. So don't consider failure as the end of the world. Take it as a positive, take it as a, because it's part of success. So you take failure not as the opposite of success, but as a part of the success. So thank you all for your patience. And if you have any questions or doubts, we can solve it right away. Any questions? Hello, Suresh sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Any questions from any participant?
Oh, no.
Or I should consider myself lucky that the presentation was self-elaborative, so no questions are there.
Yes. There are some comments on the YouTube about the presentation, all the things.
Okay.
It is quite clear and elaborative and understandable. So might be all the things has been grasped by the participants.
Okay.
So might be there are no questions. So we'll wind up the session as I think all the things has been cleared by you in your presentation.
Okay.
So thank you, Ismail, for.
Thanks a lot, sir.
For such an insightful and informative session on this process engineering in a systematic way. I'm damn sure that all the participants will get benefited by the knowledge and the experience that you had shared with all. Thanks for accepting our invitation and sharing the knowledge in the field of process engineering. Now it gives me immense pleasure to propose a vote of thanks to our dignitaries. I would like to thank our founder, Dr. Patanjali Kadam sir, Chancellor, Dr. Shivaji Rao Kadam sir, Pro Vice Chancellor, Dr. Vishwajit Kadam sir, and Vice Chancellor, Manik Rao Sanke sir, for continuous guidance and motivation to organize such kind of webinars. I would like to thank our director, Dr. Vilas Rao Kadam sir, Principal, Dr. Sandhya Jadhav ma'am, and head of the department, Dr. Shyamala Shingare, for supporting and guiding in all the way throughout the organizing such kind of webinars. I would like to thank Professor Ranjit Mane, who is the system administrator, who is looking after all the activities of, you know, online live streaming and broadcasting of such kind of webinars. I would like to thank our teaching staff, non-teaching staff, students, and last but not the least, the participant without whom the webinar would not be a grand success. Thank you all. Thanks for attending the webinar. Thank you. Thank you, Ismail.
Thanks a lot, sir, for inviting me. Thanks.
Thank you.